there may well be ways in which they may shape the results of the service sector. Our process in this is trying to have an effective and fair and efficient way of reaching the most vulnerable children who exist in pockets across the whole world. There are exceptionally vulnerable children in pockets in West Berlin, as there are wider sweeps of more vulnerable children in the world. So this is about being very fair, but having a focus on the most vulnerable and getting the right spread with the resources that we have for the council. During their inspection of April last year. Are they
conscious of doing so. Your interruption has made that more difficult. So anyway, would you like to carry on?
I would, yes. In terms of the single service referrals into the gateway, there was consultation on that, and that went through the local strategic board, the local safeguarding board, the LSTB, and there was changes to that in terms of it being a way that partners could respond more quickly instead of waiting for the locality meeting on a once-a-week basis. And the locality meeting once a week in each of those areas. What providers told us, what other organisations told us, is that they could respond more quickly to the single point of access to families who only wanted one service. So we referred that, we re-looked at that on the basis that that's what other organisations were telling us that was best suited to them. What happens then is the families still come to the locality meeting, but retrospectively, because what we don't want to miss is where there are other services working in a single way with each of those families. So you could have four single services thinking that they are the only service working with the family. So we still have to bring that back in to have a look at it to make sure that there's a joint approach and the families aren't repeating their story time and time again, which we know is the failing of the families. So it was consulted on, it did go through the LSTB, information was sent out, and we had held back on the implementation date, not on the referral.
Thank you very much. I'm now moving on to Jeanette.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you both. And it's just two quick questions. All we have mentioned of this council's core priorities on is to protect the most vulnerable. So maybe if you could, in very broad terms, explain why a targeted approach is approaching versus fulfills that priority. And just quickly, we've also mentioned about outreach services. If you can expand a little bit on the role and the importance of outreach services.
Targeting the offer is a statutory requirement on our survey. So we have had to look at that and we've had to look at which children we will target. It's also about to reduce the resource, because grants no longer available and ring fence money for children's services, children's centre services has been reduced and gone. Increased take and improved outcomes for those in greatest need is a priority, and those who do not access services for numerous reasons. So children in need, children looked after, are seriously underachieving in terms of the EYFS outcomes. So we have to target the service, we have to make best use of the rural pounds, and we have to ensure more than anything else that outcomes for our most vulnerable children and their families are improved. And that's the reason why we look at targeting the offer. It also enables us to identify and match needs service, and it allows us to focus on families least likely to engage. And that then takes us into the answer that you want on the why outreach. Outreach is a evidence-based, proven method of working with families. It comes all the way back from short start days. And it's not that this authority has not worked with an outreach footprint before. But we haven't done that in terms of it looking at the targeted families. And that's the change of it. So it will work in a more defined way on outreach and working with those targeted families in the future.
Thanks. Okay, Bruce.
My question is for Julia. I think the reason for the call into mind is all to do with the review and how the review was actually carried out in the first place. Now, during your presentation, you said that during the course of the review, we had a very happy way. You also said that we were waiting for a bearing platform to indicate that time restraints were in place. Do you believe that if we'd had longer, that the review could be more thorough and could satisfy the needs of the service providers?
That was to Julia.
Yes. I don't know. I actually think we I just know how Deborah has worked on this. Deborah joined the authority in November 2013. Deborah's background is early years of children. She lives it, she breathes it, she understands it to her fingertips. So Deborah has an absolute passion to get this right for our
have got a Birmingham platform because we have the Birkenhead cluster inspection. None of us, least of all Deborah, likes us to be described in our print. That inspection was helpful though to the authority in highlighting some of the, it was a real challenge to us in highlighting some of the key issues and helped us to get right underneath the surface of some of the issues we need to grapple with. So we have literally from April to August really when the report was due to really gather as much rich information as possible. I don't know if we have 6 months or 9 months to do a review, whether that would have led us to a different conclusion, whether we'd have reached different parts. I think some of the review is challenging some people's assumptions or foregone held conclusions about this being a really high quality service and we're doing all right. So that was really challenging people's perceptions as well. So I'm not actually sure that it suffered from the time scale because there was an absolute focus and dedication. This is a big job, but that Deborah's given to us. And her links nationally and regionally in terms of what best practice looks like has really helped shape something that I think is solid for us to go out and consult on.
Thank you. I've got David Elton and then I'm in with you.
Thank you very much, Chair. Repeated discussion to the Rural Link Forum very briefly. Two questions. The first one is they have made the point that the review process was undertaken without representation of a number of bodies there, maybe some others that haven't actually been mentioned. Can you confirm that that actually did not happen? In other words, some people were excluded totally inadvertently, but possibly definitely from the process that led to the review being produced. Before you answer that, may I say I'm very impressed by the knowledge that both of you clearly have of genuine clear knowledge about what you're doing. But we're not here tonight to discuss that, we're here to discuss the in-depth consultation process. So going back to the question very briefly, Chair, are you in agreement with the statement made by the Rural Link Forum that the people mentioned in that article weren't actually reviewed? That's the first question. And the second question is, if you accept that, and that I think it's essential to establish that fact, what process are you going to undertake to ensure other people who might need to be consulted are actually going to be consulted? Because that, I think, is what we're all concerned about. No decisions are made without adequate, proper consultation. So those two questions, please, Julia and Deborah.
I will start very
briefly.
Thank you for inevitably, we will have inadvertently missed some people in the review process. That's certainly not been deliberate. We've attempted to reach as many people as possible through the children's centres, 16 children's centres, and through various partnership groups for children that exist in the room. So that is what I'd say as a starter. But there will have been some people inadvertently missed. But that is certainly not our intention. Our intention is to reach as many people on a local level as possible.
I think Harry is right in that. People have been making it hasn't been it wasn't any intent to make sure to make the review process a narrow process or a less informed process. And I can only say that in terms of the statements that Forum, I have evidence to say that we were definitely invited to sit as part of the four workshops. Information from the review was also taken to the Children's Trust and to other areas where those people were part of. In terms of the Link Forum, I find it a little disappointing, and Olin Longman's not here tonight, but the Longman worked at the time two offices away. And so had she been as disappointed as the Link Forum was saying there was a disappointed, I would appreciated
the conversation during that
form
period. It's difficult to.
It is very, very difficult.
But I have information.
Yeah,
I'd like to invite it,
but there was all the conversations happening at the time.
Just sorry, a quick conclusion. Can you tell us how you're going to ensure that people in the future will be consulted? Because I think it's the concern of a lot of the audience.
Eileen, and then Walter, and then Phil Douglas, and then Brian.
Thanks very much for sharing with us your aspirations for the service. But what the point I wanted to make was that every consultation that Wilbur Council has ever had has always been criticised by those people that don't agree with the changes to any service. But something that did come out tonight was that it was alleged that there were no note-taking and no feedback to the people taking part in the consultation process. Can you tell me, is that the case? If it wasn't the case, can we have it confirmed that the ongoing consultations will be noted and will be thorough feedback to those participants?
My understanding of that was that I've already expressed that it was a local, not a public consultation, and information would have flowed through the advisory board, which are governance for our children's centres. So they decided who they would be consulting with, and information would have gone back and to that way. Information was also used to advise the document, and I would strongly say that in terms of the outcomes of public consultation, we would have to publish that anyway.
Chair, I'm just very briefly out that the documentation does refer to people's comments and bullet points. So the issue about buildings or people, a lot of people were saying we don't care about where the building is as long as we stick to the region we know. And just as a flavour to some of the feedback that's within this documentation that's informed the review.
The cabinet recommendation and the committee papers both talk about progress the recommendations. Earlier, you, Chair, Julia referred to testing things. So I think it would have been wiser to say progress and test or check the recommendations rather than imply these are the recommendations. That's just a comment.
Chair,
so, I'm doing well. Reference has been made to the Birkenhead cluster report, And I discovered that by rooting around Ofsted site. I don't know who amongst the members here has read it all, so quoting bits can be unfair, because it does say that the Centre Group leadership and staff are hardworking, extremely committed, just sort of balanced by saying they're overstretched and under supported by the local authority. So it's a mixed report. But what I wanted to tease out of that document was this issue of outcomes and targeting. In the inspection judgment, it said the staff do not track, and it might have been put right since, so I understand that, because it's 8 months ago. The staff do not track how many of the families from their identified target groups attend most services and activities, or how often, or what difference this is making to their outcomes, including those who experience poor parenting. So, our assurance is that process, whatever we set up, whatever the scrutiny of it by families and well-being, that we have that tracking in post. The next thing I want to test, and I referred to it earlier, and again, perhaps other members don't have one, the government going in, say, 2013, it had two things local authorities must do, and 10 things local authorities should do. I'm not going to read them all out. The key bits, just three bits. Local authorities should ensure that children's centres and their services are within reasonable reach of all families with young children in urban and rural areas, taking into account distance and transport. So I test that that's the case in this. Another point, target children's centres and young children families in the area who are at risk of poor outcomes through, for example, effective outreach services based on analysis of local need, which I think is point placed by these important people. And finally, one bullet point, local authorities should not close an existing children's centre site in any reorganisation provision unless they can demonstrate that where they decide to close a children's centre site, the outcomes for children, particularly the most disadvantaged, would not be adversely affected and will not compromise the duty to have sufficient children's centres to meet local need. The key things that's in the document.
There's a question in there.
There is. I want to test that what I've just referred to is being tested in this process, so that the document which is to progress the recommendations is tested against the very things I've just drawn to your attention.
Okay, thank you.
I'd start by saying yes, we will. Some reassurance about the work that's taken place around tracking processes since the vote of their custom inspection, because that has been a real focus. We've not been able to wait for any new to be implemented. We need to track and target our most vulnerable children, and there's evidence we're making progress along that journey. The final point I'll cover before handing over to them is that we've got to copy the point we made about Council Gilchrist about making sure that we don't adversely affect in any area as we consider where our children's centres are located. One comment I would like to make is, as we, and Deborah's referred and I've referred to the Children's Trust on a number of occasions, and this is a parent body that has partner agencies in first families for children. So in respect of children being ready for school, we are talking about the local authority reducing its budget for children's centres to 2.3 million. That has to be sat in the context of commissioning of health services, health visitors and family nurse partnership coming over to the local authority to commission that service. So that's £5 million coming in. There's a lot of stipulations about how that can be spent, but that's on what to find the levels. There's also approximately £16 million in rural for the 2, 3, and 4 year old offer, and that's nursery provision for our most vulnerable youngsters. So 2 year old offers being extended to reach those children who, if they were at school, would be eligible for these school payments. So as we look at this, we must sit it in a partnership context. So as we talk about reaching our most vulnerable children, it's how our preschool and our private nurseries with the two schools with the 2, 3, 4 year old offer, our health visitors with our dedicated campus partnership, and our local authority outreach service reach these people. So our consultation with health, our consultation with schools, our consultation with the private voluntary paid sector as part of this 6 week process is critical.
Say, for example, Kathy's need to offer some feedback about that before we take it into account and reflect it in our filing. Is that the case?
Good. Okay, I would just like to just make one comment, yes.
It's just clarification, maybe. What's just taking place? The recommendation, the consultation is on that recommendation. What I've heard from what Kathy said, she doesn't have to go through the recommendation. And I think that we're on the whole with its review, and I know that people
people have said it is a start of the 10. It really is a start of the 10. We need to continue to be more progressive going forward. But I think that the Suffolk report has been much more ambitious and inspirational than the Wirral report.
I have to say, in my most recent conversation with Matthew, he actually agreed that Wirral was rather cautious in his approach. So at that point, I say thank you very much. And now we move on to the last part of the procedure, which is I invite Councillor Hayes to come forward, and you have 5 minutes to start.
Detain the committee for much longer. I think we've had very detailed questions and very detailed answers from both sets of witnesses, and I think all members from all political groups will hopefully understand that this has been an extremely useful exercise in scrutinising not just the decision of Cabinet but the service more widely. And I think everyone involved in the service will be appreciative of the committee's time in advance to this. Can I just take you back to the evidence given by the officers? One thing that really stuck out for me was when Julia said she's not sure if we had longer we would have come to a different conclusion. Now, I know Julia's earlier said she misspoke on another item and perhaps used the wrong word, but she said their conclusion. And she's also said that this document is a start at the 10. Now, quite frankly, it's not a start at the 10. There are figures mentioned in there. There's an apportionment of money. We were talking about 1.1 million before. There are numbers in terms of the numbers of children's centres mentioned. It's not a start of the 10. It's a document that has been produced, I would argue, my witnesses certainly argued, which has come out of a consultation which has seriously been flawed. We had World Cafe events where parents and service users were invited to make their comments. All well and good. I don't think they fully appreciated what they were brought to comment about and what they were there for. They didn't understand that this was a proper consultation exercise. We heard from Steve Bazy, and I'm paraphrasing here, but in effect he was hoodwinked into a consultation exercise that he didn't even know he was part of. I mean that's the state of things as we stand. Now this is the document upon which any consultation will take place. I argue it is completely flawed. Now, if the committee is not with me on this, I know the committee and all members will be keen that whatever consultation follows is open, is inclusive, and is transparent. Now, hopefully the officers have said they've already got a draft timetable. Hopefully they're listening to us this evening, and perhaps that draft timetable can change and alter, because I certainly think 6 weeks from now, on a document which is so deficient in terms of the views of all stakeholders, is not long enough, and we need to have a longer consultation in relation to this issue. Chair, I know that Julia said that Deborah Gornick lives, breathes, years and children's centres. Well, I'll tell you who lives and breathes it, the staff behind me. They were only mentioned once in the evidence this evening. We need to make sure they are fully consulted, and they should have been fully consulted in relation to this document rather than afterwards on in terms of the staffing structures which may follow. We need to make sure we have full consultation with the voluntary community and faith sector. We can't deliver that within the 6 week time frame we currently have.
Thank you very much. And now I invite Councillor Smith to come forward, and you will also have 5 minutes then.
Okay, thank you, Chair. Thanks, committee. I know it's been a long sort of evening and it's carried on for a long time. First of all, can I just reiterate what the director and the assistant director say? And I totally accept what David said, and I give you an absolute promise that we will have adequate and proper consultation. And we are absolutely certain we want to get this right. Now, the landscape has changed nationally, not just locally. Nationally, with the 2013 Act, we have to focus on outcomes. We really have to, for our most disadvantaged young people in that lot to buy. Now, that's the 20%. So, not having had any review in the authority since 2002, I think it was imperative that we did look at this situation. Now, obviously, money does come into it. because we have to make efficiency savings. We've had draconian cuts in this authority over the last 4 years, 150 million. One third of the early intervention grant nationally and here has been cut. It's no longer ring fenced. So, you know, we have got a different landscape in that. But we want to get it right for our most disadvantaged children. I agree, I looked at the report that was done by Frank Field and Suffolk. Absolutely correct. We do not need to concentrate on buildings. It is on specific outcomes for young people. That is the most important thing. That is what Ofsted is saying now. It's saying that we have got to make sure that the outcomes are... I agree with this coalition government having said that, because I think it should have been said 20 years ago. We did good things in children's centres in the early years and that, but for me, the outcomes were not good. We had children going into our schools who were cognitively 2-3 years behind the chronological age, and to catch up in that short, in that period of time, it took our primary schools a number of years. If we get that right, we're going to be doing something right, in my view. So I just hope that the views that have been put forward today, either by the witnesses for Paul or the officers, will be part of that consultation. I want it as wide as possible. I don't want to exclude anyone from the consultation. If we get it right, I think we'll be doing a fantastic service for our early years in the next 5 or 6 years, and we must get that right. So thank you for your attention tonight. Thank you for the way you brought back the review to the committee and that. And I can assure you, we would welcome coming back to the scrutiny committee again when we actually complete the consultation.
Thanks. I'm going to open it up for discussion to members at the moment. Thank you. And then I'm hoping that following on from that discussion, we will be able to reach a decision. We only have two decisions open to us, I think, right? The middle one doesn't apply tonight. So that is either that we refer the decision back to the member to be considered, or that we withdraw the decision. So I'm hoping to comment on that.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, all of us. This is such a comprehensive report. I'm personally unhappy with the three consultations that
So can I ask those in favour of Tom's seconded? Those in favour, please show. Right. And those against? That's lost. And now can I take the recommendation put forward by Paul, which is that we uphold the decision to have a member. Seconded? Okay. All those in favour, please show. Thank you. Now can I thank everybody for their attendance? Oh, those against? It's too much shit. any abstentions? No. Thank you very much. Can I thank everybody for their attendance tonight? We see members that know it's difficult for you, the witnesses, very difficult.